Okay, I'm the British person because I'm wearing the shorts in the middle of October in Spain, all right, okay? Because this for me is summer out there, okay? So, otherwise I'll be too warm. I'm Philip Griffiths. I'm Professor of Building Physics and Head of School at the School of Built Environment at Ulster University. We'll tell you a little bit about where Ulster University is at the moment. This person here, you may not recognize him with his shades on next to our sunbed. This is our sunbed here. We do a lot of solar energy research in Northern Ireland, and our weather is normally like that there. So we need one of these here because we don't always see the sun. So we have a big solar simulator. Anyway, anybody recognize that man there?
George Clooney?
Not George Clooney, but he would be very pleased. I will tell him at graduation that you thought he was George Clooney, okay? Wrong computer. Right. Okay. Okay. So do you know which film these characters are from?
The Hobbit.
Yes. So this gentleman here is Prof, and this man is our chancellor, the head of our university. He is the head of the university in the United Kingdom is always a ceremonial position. Okay, so he is our Chancellor, Jim Nesbitt, and he is from the hometown of my university. Okay, so he's a famous actor in Britain, has done a lot of work on television and in films and things. So this was him as one of the dwarfs in the Hobbit. Okay, so where are we? Okay, so I just want to explain where we are. So the United Kingdom, we're in Northern Ireland, and we're 1 hour's flight away from London, 2 hours flight from Barcelona, but it took me all day yesterday to get here. It was a bit like the 1980s American film with Chevy Chase, trains, planes, and automobiles. So I took a taxi to the airport, I took a flight to London, and a flight from there to Barcelona, because there was no direct flights yesterday, and then I took a train from Barcelona to here. Oh, and a bus as well, so everything. The only thing I didn't do was a boat, but we'll leave that, okay? So, and Belfast is known for its culture. So very vibrant city with a lot of culture taking place. So we even do street theatre. You can see that there. So it doesn't always rain. Yeah, she's left the room. So Maria was talking about sort of it raining when she was in Dublin last. We're also famous for this building. It gives it a bit of a way here with the title here, okay? The Titanic. The Titanic was built in Belfast. And this is the building that houses the Titanic Museum. A museum all about a disaster and about a ship that sank. That says a lot about Northern Ireland and our sense of humour and culture and things. So, but this building, you can see these bits here sticking out. They represent the height and the front of the bow of the ship. So, the university itself has four campuses within Northern Ireland. So this is Northern Ireland, the northern part of the island of Ireland, which is part of the United Kingdom, while the Republic of Ireland is the south, the other three quarters of the island. And we have four campuses. We have a campus in the northwest, in Coleraine, and also in the city of Derry. And we have two campuses in the Belfast area, one in the city centre, which is an art and design campus. And the campus that I work at is a place called Jordanstown, and that's where the engineering campus is. But the thing about that, we are moving that campus into Belfast in a number of years' time. So, just jump to two slides. So the city centre campus is a new building, and this has just been built. And in 2019, we will move our energy research into this building. The top of the building is our art faculty. And at the moment, we're based out here in a campus in Jordanstown, and this is the library. A very interesting building because I had a hand in it's the origination of this library back in about 2000. And as you can see here, there is a lot of brise-soleil and overhangs primarily to protect that building from summer sunshine. So one of the slides that was shown earlier by Anna Laura had a picture of a building, if you remember it, so very early on, and it showed summer sun, winter sun, and everything else like that there. And so by actually having these brise-soleil and this overhangs and everything else, we protected that building from a lot of solar gain. Because when we modeled this building for the architects, we were coming up with temperatures inside about 60 degrees centigrade in summer. So it can get warm in Northern Ireland, but only in the summer. Okay, but that relates to some of the reasons why we use PCM to control for thermal comfort and things. The university is very large, so we have something like 27,000 students at the largest university on the whole of the island of Ireland, and lots of facilities for the students to use. We have one of the centres for sport within the United Kingdom, one of the four centres for sport in the United Kingdom is based on the campus. And so that's open for the students to be able to book and use as well as others. Now, this is what I'm here to talk to you about. Uncertainty in measurement. Now, you've seen some very interesting talks today, both by Anna Laura and by Professor Farid, talking about experimental analysis and experimental work. Now, in terms of what they've talked about, what do you think allows them to present that work? And, you know, present it to you, present it publicly. What do they have in their heart about that work that allows them to stand up here and say, these are our results?
They're confident about the results.
They have a confidence about the results. That's exactly true. And that's what we're looking for when we undertake experimental work. And to be able to get that confidence, we need to know what our uncertainties are, to be able to measure them, to be able to quantify them, okay? And so I'm going to talk to you about how we can do that. Some of you may have already undertaken some of this work already, so I'm standing here telling you something that you already know. So bear with me on that. The problem is, you see, we live in a society where, you know, things occur and, you know, they're mistakes, they're blunders, they're errors and things like that there. So this is a Parisian station, and as you can see that this driver hasn't managed to stop his train before crashing through the end stops and out through the side there. I don't know, sadly, if anybody lost their life in it and things like that there. It does look catastrophic. I hope the driver was able to jump clear before he went through the wall. It could have happened through a number of reasons. Through the driver error, not spotting the signals, not being aware of the conditions of the track. So there was too much maybe sort of moisture on the tracks, and therefore the ability for the train to have friction and to be able to grip the rails as it was trying to slow down wasn't there, and he slid through the end there. Maybe he missed a signal. Maybe something went wrong with the braking system and it wasn't working, which you then have to ask what happened with the person who was maybe maintaining the locomotive, and were they doing their job, or did some piece of machinery break or something like that because it had worn out, or there was some sort of failure because of a microscopic element within the metalwork that had failed that back in those days they wouldn't have spotted, but these days with a lot of facilities we are able to check a lot of metallurgy and other things like that. We also get things wrong in a very embarrassing way. So I'm looking round, and I would say practically everybody in this room may not have actually been born when this happened. I can't remember what it was now, 1989. Okay, hands up if you were born after 1989. See, so some of you were, but most of you were children, yeah? Yeah, so please nod, yeah? Okay, all right, okay. Right, okay. I was in college when this happened, and when we saw this came out, it feels, oh, brilliant, and everything else. The answer to our energy solutions and everything else like that there. So these two people, and their names were Martin Fleischmann and Stanley Pons. Martin Fleischmann was from the University of Southampton in England, and Stanley Pons was from the University of Utah. Now, the thing about it was that they worked together, and they were trying to come up with what we called cold fusion. So fusion in a test tube that didn't require sort of lots of amounts of energy to initiate it. Fusion for power, for those of you who don't understand it, is sort of the opposite of fission, So with fission, which is our traditional way of using nuclear energy, where we bombard large isotopes of things like uranium and plutonium with neutrons and get them to split. And as a result of that split, we get a release of energy. Okay, so that's fission. Within fusion, we're trying to bond very small sort of atoms. Yeah, usually based around sort of atoms of water, but sort of with sort of heavy water or things like that. We're looking at hydrogen atoms and things like that. Okay, so we end up sometimes with water out of the system, but they're trying to sort of look at those sort of things. Now, the fusion project in England, which is where the Joint European Torus is based, a place called Culham. They are doing this at very high temperatures in plasmas. So there's a lot of energy required to get this going. And they've never got to a stage where they're able to sustain the process. But if we can get fusion to work and we can solve fusion, we go a long way to solving our energy crisis. That's why the European Union puts a huge amount of money into this research. So do the Americans, so do the Japanese. And so this is where this all came about and everything else. And they said that they had managed to create cold fusion in a test tube, solving the energy crisis. Now, 1989, so 1999, 2009, we're talking about 27 years ago. And what happened was that they made mistakes during their experimental process. When people came to try to replicate what they did, they couldn't replicate it, okay? And what had happened was that they had gone ahead and published their work without checking things and rechecking things. And as a result of it, there was no confidence in what they had proposed. Okay? So that's why what we do, it's very important that we have a confidence in what we're reporting. This went worldwide. This was so embarrassing for these people. It was for the universities and everything else. Some errors are good to report. So this is taken from the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. And these are the projections out of the 2007 report talking about where the climate will go in terms of global climate change. And as you can see, there are different bands. You notice that this black band here has a very narrow band of error in this particular period of time, because we knew what the temperatures were. And as we go backwards, you notice that the band widens, because therefore we are predicting temperatures. And those temperatures are being predicted from things like ice cores and other things like that there. So there's an error being built in. From here, errors are increasing as we go forward, because the models, as the models expand, therefore there's greater variability with our boundary conditions, and it's very difficult for them to be able to pinpoint exactly what's happening. But as a result of that, you have these error bands here around these means in terms of the predictions, depending upon the different scenarios. So B1 under the climate change model was very much about us going ahead with significant change to our energy diet and making considerable amount of changes so that we could achieve a reduction in sort of global warming compared with A2 and also A1F1. A1F1, I think, is business as normal, business as usual, which heads us towards a 4-degree warming and catastrophic problems for things like the Sahel, the countries in the Pacific, where sea level rises will practically wipe them out, and other issues. We're already beginning to see a lot of problems now with climate anyway, due to a lot of energy being in the atmosphere, changing what's happening with climate and things. But these bands give us the idea that, you know, the computer modeling is saying roughly about here, but here's the spread over which things could happen. So, you know, what's telling us here is that, you know, we could have anything from a 2-degree warming to a 6-degree warming. So within that band somewhere, that could fall, okay? Even a 2-degree warming is bad enough. A 6-degree warming is catastrophic for us going forward. So it's right that we use errors and we promote errors to say that sort of, that the information we have now is limited. But as we get towards this point here, as we go towards here, these will narrow and narrow and narrow and everything else. But it's important that we promote this. So, we want to seek truth. The question is, what is truth? we have our experimental work to undertake. So a lot of you will be involved in the laboratory on experimental work. The question is that what you're undertaking that experimental work for. So what are you undertaking that experimental work for? How hands up who's doing a PhD? Okay. So what's the aim of your PhD? What's the aim of your PhD? Okay, what's the aim of your PhD specifically?
Improvement of design in ultimately to improve energy efficiency.
Okay, so that improvement of design. So in your thesis, you will have a hypothesis, which is that these things will allow me to improve the design. Okay, so what you have something is you want to prove. Okay, so are you undertaking experimental work to do that?
Yes.
Okay, so your experimental work is to prove your hypothesis. Okay, so that's what we want to be able to do in experimentation. We want it to be able to prove a hypothesis and everything else. We'll also need, so hands up who's doing a computer-based system. Okay, you're doing a computer-based system, yeah? Okay, so again, you need to be able to validate your model, don't you? So we need to maybe do some experimental work, or you maybe got experimental work that you have that's validating that model and everything else. Again, you need to be able to prove that and everything else. So we've got experimentation that we need to be sure of. We're going to be measuring. What are we measuring? We could be measuring temperature. We could be measuring enthalpy. We could be measuring, if you're using a DSC, we're going to be measuring sort of the specific heat capacity of something. And we've seen some of that data come through this morning. But how do you know that that data is accurate? We've got things such as accuracy and repeatability issues, and we're going to come on and talk about that there. So what is accuracy of data, but also that repeatability? It's important that we be able to repeat our results. It's important that we're not taking a one-off result. So we'll come and talk about that a bit more. We'll be looking a lot in so far, I'm going to be talking about with regard to statistical work, but not all measurements are statistical, but all observations have some sort of level of confidence. So we need to sort of take those things into account. So how well do we know and trust what really counts and comes back to this accuracy and repeatability? And if we can have some sort of level of how accurate our work is and how repeatable our work is, we can then go back to that confidence that we mentioned earlier. Okay. So repeatability is the cornerstone of what we're trying to do. But the thing about it is that not all observations are truly repeatable. So we'll repeat and we'll get a slightly different answer. We'll repeat and get a slightly different answer again. So we end up then with statistical data that we need to analyze, and we need to be able to get something out of that. What's the differences between those successive measurements? Do we understand what the differences are? Do we understand what's causing those differences? What are our boundary conditions? And we have to start thinking about our boundary conditions. So Anna Laura talked about a cabinet and a chamber. And in terms of that work, she will have been using that cabinet as her boundary conditions and setting boundary conditions around which she was doing her measurements and things like this. Some observations are generally unique, such as individual human behavior, because we're all individually different. Okay, give you an example. Okay, thermal comfort, which is one of my areas of research. All right, I'm thermally comfortable today. Okay, all right. Okay, some of you are wearing thick trousers, jumpers, some of you are sort of wearing scarves and things like that there, and you're thermally comfortable. All right. So we can both say that both people are thermally comfortable, but they have a different response to that thermal comfort. So individual things, supernova is another thing. Each supernova is very different from another one. So there are things that when we measure them are unique and different, and we have to be able to try and sort of analyze those. So some things also occur because of random chance. We have to build that into everything that we're looking at. But most of our data actually sort of looks, and I get this thing about sort of that we have a combination of both. We have a combination of sort of the uniqueness but also random chance. So how do we take that data and be able to use that data? Now, before I start to look at statistical analysis and everything else, what I'm going to do is talk very quickly about instrumentation. And as Louisa's got this, I've got a form of this in a PDF, okay? So, and a lot of the text that I've got on my notes here, I've actually put into the PDFs here and everything else like that there. So you'll get all these slides afterwards, okay? All right. So, so you'll have that. So instrumentation. These are some of the things that you need to be careful of. And it's worth working with your lab technician or your lecturer with regard to these issues. So when was it last calibrated? Certain pieces of equipment will need recalibrated annually, will need recalibrated maybe every 5 years. When was it last calibrated? If it's been calibrated, there will be a calibration certificate. And on that, there'll be a lot of data with regard to the error that your piece of equipment gives, or sort of to how many decimal points, significant figures, is that particular piece of equipment reading and things. These are very important for you to know. To what standard is it being produced? So quite often, if you're measuring something, it'll be to an ISO standard or an CE standard or an ANSI standard. So be aware of what you're measuring here. And that leads to sort of what is the error from this. And I'll talk a bit about different pieces of equipment and what the error is, because some of the pieces of equipment is very surprising what the error is. Thermocouples, we're all doing thermal work. So you saw some work undertaken by Professor Farid where he's measuring the thermal conductivity of a slurry. Now, I've been working with slurries, not so much in the last number of years, but I was working for slurries for about 10 years from about 2000 onwards. And I worked with some people in Switzerland. And we couldn't actually, you know, so at that time, it was impossible to know what the thermal conductivity of a slurry was. So we actually had to work out how to actually measure the thermal conductivity of slurries. And so it required invasive measurement using thermocouples. And we had to sort of know exactly what the effect of those thermocouples were having on the particular measurements, but also what thermocouples we were using and things, and that's very important. So, with regard to thermocouples, is the thermocouple correct for the temperature range? That's a very interesting aspect. Because you walk into the lab and you say to the lab technician, I need thermocouples, and you say, right, there you go, boom, there's thermocouples there. Okay, right, am I talking about low temperature? So, ambient temperatures? So, I've got some type T thermocouples, okay for that. By talking about, am I working on Louisa's high temperature rig? Actually, maybe need type K thermocouples for this. So make sure that you're getting the right thermocouples for the particular temperature range. Two wire or four wire? Anybody know what I'm talking about there? Anybody use four wire thermocouples? No? Anybody, yes? Any idea? Come on, right. Okay, so, okay, think about it, the fact that you're sitting here in front of me and it's an undergrad lecture and everything else. No answer that anybody will give me is a wrong answer. All right, okay. So I want to see a bit of interaction with yourselves. Anybody can hazard a guess as to why you would use a four-wire thermocouple compared with a two-wire thermocouple? Go ahead. When you're measuring small temperature differences, it can be very useful. In fact, actually, one of the problems we have when we're measuring small temperature difference, especially in the ambient, is that our problem actually becomes that our error as a percentage, and I'll come on to this, is actually very large compared with the temperature difference. And so we have a problem there with regard to our confidence. So actually using four wire can be very useful in that regard. What we use four wire for is to compensate. It takes away some of those electrical signals that interfere with our two wire measurements and everything else. We really actually power in. With a four wire, we tend to be powering the actual thermocouple itself. And so we eliminate some of the problems and issues with regard to that. The problem with a four wire system is that if you think about it, okay, you've got a two wire system. So you say you've got a data collector with 30 terminals. That allows you to have 30 pairs of terminals, okay? So you can have 30 thermocouples. You go to four wire, what does that do? 15 thermocouples. So immediately you can measure fewer points, you then need a second data logger, or you need an extension to your data logger. So please, Louisa, can I have an extension to my data logger? You think I'm made of money? You know, everything else. So, you know, so for these sort of responses. So you have to think about these sort of things. Accuracy is money. Okay, so there are these sort of links. You have to get those right. PT100s is a particular type of thermocouple, and you know, it's a better than a TK, a TOK, but it is much more expensive. So these things you have to think about. So, and then again, the measuring accuracy of the data logger itself. So back to that calibration. Have you got it set up in terms of a thermal bridge or cold bridge, or is there a cold junction inside that data logger that's measuring your temperature? Is that calibrated and things like this? These are the sort of things you have to think about before you even start your experimental data. Okay, so going back to that methodology and everything else like that is very important. And my computer's timed out, so there you go. So, our measurements. Are the measurements you're collecting those that you wish to collect? We have a problem. It's called big data. All right. We end up with lots of data and everything else, and you're sifting through the data, and some of the data is totally irrelevant, other data is relevant. It takes your time, it gets in your way and everything else. Make sure that what you're collecting is relevant to what you wish, so that you can reduce the amount of time that you spend looking at data. But the other aspect of that as well is that make sure that sort of you have the right amount of data, you're not missing something. So look at some of the measurements. What's causing differentials across measurements? So let's say you didn't take the trip to the test cells. Is that correct, Louisa?
Yeah, that's right.
You haven't had the trip. Okay,
it was
right.
Falling water.
Okay, right. In some of the test cells, Louisa has they have sort of cells with two rooms in them. Okay, so there's one room here and there's another room here. Okay, all right. And they measure in heat flow between one space and another space. So I want to measure generally what the surface of this wall is between the two rooms, okay? So how many thermocouples will I put on that wall? What's the minimum number of thermocouples I should put on that wall to know the temperature I'm getting? All right. Have a guess, though. How many thermocouples should I put on that wall? Should I just put one thermocouple?
Maybe at least two to compensate the fact that air temperature will vary.
Good point. Okay, right.
On a single wall?
Five? Why five?
You can put four corner and
okay. One in the middle. Okay. You raise an interesting thing about sort of the spread, the temperature here and everything else like this there. It's a very interesting case because, you know, the temperature will change across that wall. But let's say that that wall is just all uniform one temperature. How many thermocouples do I need?
I would put two.
You put two? One, two, okay. Bids, higher, lower? You can't go lower than one. Yeah, we can, but not in this case, okay?
I would put two not because of the temperature difference.
Okay.
Of level, it's just to check that I have consistency.
Okay, so I've got my two thermocouples, okay? Okay, so we've got one thermocouple and we get a reading from it, okay? I've got two thermocouples, I have two readings. One says 24 degrees, one says 26 degrees. Which is right. Do, 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 do. You know, we enter the sort of twilight zone. Okay? So, should I put a three? Okay? All of a sudden, I'm taking one measurement and I've got three measurements. Okay? But if I've got three, if one is wrong, the other two are going to tell me it's right. Now, statistically, that one that's given me a result that's different to the others may be the right one and the other two. But if you've done your work correctly and calibrating them at the start, you won't have these particular issues and things like that there. So if I'm measuring one particular temperature, I would put three thermocouples on, which means you end up with lots of data. Okay, so you have to think about these sort of issues and make sure that you're getting the right amount of data and everything else. Invasive or non-invasive testing. Okay, I've used this word invasive testing a few minutes ago. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? Invasive? Yeah? Exactly, yes. So let's go back to the wall in our test chamber again. I put a thermocouple in the middle of that wall. And you're quite right to say that there could well be a temperature differential across that wall because of convection and the airflow across that surface. If I put a thermocouple in the middle of that wall, it's going to disturb the flow of air across that. Similarly, that thermocouple will be metal, therefore it will have a thermal conductivity with the surface and things like that there and everything else. So there's lots of issues with regard to invasive testing that can disrupt the experimental result that you're trying to achieve. Non-invasive testing is a good way of doing these types of things, and we can do that by using thermal cameras. But we then have to make sure our thermal camera is calibrated and it's correct and everything else. Can anybody use the thermal camera? Yep, okay. What's the one thing you have to make sure that you've got right on the thermal camera when you're measuring a surface?
You have to set some parameters before starting measurement. You have to put the correct distance between you and the surface you're measuring.
Yep.
So the outdoor parameters.
Yes, temperature, yes. And the emissivity of the surface, exactly what I was looking for. But everything else was correct and everything else like that there. So again, making sure that your correct measurements are going through there, okay? So you can see these little things. Lots of issues and everything else. We haven't even started measuring yet, okay? You already got headaches going, I don't want to do experimental work. Please, Louisa, can I do something on a computer? All right, okay. So, but when we get it right, we get it correct. So our boundary conditions, our starting conditions are very important as we set these sort of issues up as we go forward. So our experimentalist goal is that we achieve this whole idea of to observe nature, to make sure that these observations are correct and that we can take global results and apply them within the universe in which we live. So these generalizations are concerned with representations of nature, theoretical models, and we want to try and work out an insight into how they are interacting and how we try to achieve that and how they're mimicking nature's behaviors. Now, blunders. You're sitting there thinking, dear me, I should have brought an English dictionary. Anybody know? A blunder is a mistake, okay? A blunder is a mistake that we make. Okay, and this is one of the things you have to think about, okay? So blunders can be explicit or implicit, right? I'll come on to what I mean by those. An explicit is one that's an overt mistake. It's intending to do the right thing, but accidentally doing something else and not realizing it. All right, okay? So you're measuring something, but you're measuring the wrong thing. Get that? Okay, so you have to work out to do with that there. A good example from chemistry is a mislabeled reagent bottle. You use the wrong reagent and everything else, and so instead of getting the perfect reaction, you get another reaction, and somebody along the line has made a mistake, a human error that's led to your mistake, whether it's you've made it or somebody else has made it, but it's an explicit mistake. Implicit is thinking that some principle is true, which is not, and proceeding from that assumption. A good explanation of this, if you're in an area of biology or biomass, is that pathogens cannot survive above 100 degrees centigrade, or all pathogens cannot survive above 100 degrees centigrade. So you're thinking about something, you've heard a general rule about something, you're applying it, but it's not correct, and therefore you've made a mistake in that area. Blunders, the thing about it is that they can only really be guarded against by vigilance. You do not reflect it in the error that you mention. It's very much about making sure you have the correct methodology. It's making sure that you are, when you're planning your research work and developing your experimental work, that you are going about things step by step and not making and not bringing any assumptions into things. The main thing about it is that this confidence can be overcome in terms by independent repetition, by somebody else doing the work, or by you using something different and measuring it against it and everything else like that there. So you can actually spot these things by doing things with independent repetition. Protection against implicit blunders can be enhanced by considering and disclosing regarding all procedures and assumptions. Going back to Pons and Fleischmann, this is where they went wrong, okay? So they made assumptions, both explicitly and implicitly, And it was found out because when people came to sort of do the independent repetition, it failed, and also sort of, but they did release all the information, and people were able to sort of check against it, and they sort of and people found that their work was not correct. So very quickly after the article that appeared in the original journal paper, people were coming along and saying, no, it's not correct, and everything else. So careful consideration has to be sort of, you know, gone through and everything else. Now, the other type of error is a systematic error. These are known uncertainties, and this is what we start to sort of plug into our system. It can be related to things like instrumentation limitations, that the resolution or the calibration, maybe a piece of instrument that you have doesn't have the resolution low enough for us to be able to sort of really say what's going on and everything else. Human limitations, so gauge region ability, talk about that in a few minutes. Knowledge limitations, the accuracy with which the fundamental constants are known. So these are sort of, you know, you'll go and read in a book. So a book that I use for physical constants is a book called by Kay and Leiby, and that's my knowledge limitation with regard to the accuracy of known constants, for example. It can never sort of reduce systematic error by increased data. We have to try and sort of build these sort of things in. So, keep hitting the wrong button. I have to hit both buttons for my notes and things. Systematic is reproducibility, inaccuracy introduced by equipment or calibration or the technique. And a lot of the things that we can do that I've talked about and I'm about to sort of talk about with regard to equipment can actually reduce this. Random errors are the indifference of results of due to the finite precision of the equipment that we're measuring. So you saw some of the graphs that Professor Farage showed, and the graphs had a sort of lines of best fit, but the data was either above or below the line and everything else. That's because when we take the measurements, you know, so the actual sort of, you know, measurements we get in, we're not getting the true measurement, we're getting things that are close to the measurements and things. And we end up with a scatter of results. So for example, if you take something like indium and you put it in a DSC, because we use indium because of its purity to be able to calibrate DSCs, you get a strong point at 157 degrees centigrade. But if we take something like a slurry or a wallboard, that's not homogeneous as material, and we put that in a DSC and we start measuring it there, then we'll, depending on the sample that we have and the constituents of that sample, we'll get a scatter of results around something. So we end up with a scatter of results. And that randomness, we need to be able to know what our error is within that randomness. And we end up sort of with this idea here. So the best way to think about it is, here's my true value, here's my systematic error here. My systematic error can be reduced. We want to bring this random set of data closer to this particular point as possible, okay? And we also try to sort of reduce that as well. So in doing that, we're trying to do two things. We want a result that's precise and accurate, okay? Our data sits here. We can have precise data, but it's not accurate because it's a systematic error. Or that data here can be spread out so that it doesn't have precision. It can be scattered as somebody's come along with a gun and just gone bop, 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 bop. Okay, and so your data is sort of so far wide, you're never going to get any sort of a real true systematic, any true sort of confidence in the data. So we need to try, if you've got starting getting data like this here, but it's off what you think the true value is, then you can think about what the systematic error is there. And one of the things that we know with regard to some of the DSC work, because of the small samples we're working on, we get this effect called supercooling and everything else. And sometimes also you have a hysteresis. And so the process as it goes one way is not the same as it goes another way and everything else. So can we eliminate those particular processes and try to move that data from there to actually closer to that true particular point? Measurement data. So I've left this all in the slides for you, so you can just pick these up and everything else like this. So when you're measuring data instruments, first thing to do is actually go and look at the handbook or flick the machine over and it might actually have the information on the back. And it'll tell you information with regard to what the measurement accuracy of this. So for example, on most digital readouts, the actual measurement will be 0.5 of whatever the last digit is there, okay? So this actually represents here that this could either be 12.8 5 or 12.75. Okay, so that's our range of accuracy in terms of reading this. And it'll change according to whatever scale that you're reading there. Okay, so think about your significant figures and those sort of other aspects as well. So you've got that data there, and because that data says 0.5 to plus 0.5, actually, because this is only reading to 0.8, you can say that this could fall between 12.7 or 12.9 and everything else. When you're writing this data, because we know that it's half of the last figure, you notice here that I'm needing to I'm saying plus or minus 0.05. Because I'm saying 0.05, I'm putting two figures after the decimal point here. And again, I'm British, so we use a point, not a comma. So I'm saying 12.80 there, because you know there's no point showing 12.8 and not actually showing that to the same amount of significant figures. So make sure that you're getting those types of things right when you're reporting data. These things are interesting. Anybody use one of these flow tube measurements? Yep. Okay. All right. I was working in the laboratory, working away. I was a postdoc. I was a young postdoc. There I had brown hair and I didn't have this. I was two stone. Okay, 14, 28. I was 50 kilograms. No, I couldn't have been 50 kilograms lighter. I was a lot lighter than I am now. Okay. I was working as a postdoc and we developed a hot box. And we were measuring the performance of glazing systems in this hot box. And I had a flow of water flowing through the hot box to cool it down. So I needed to know what my heat extract was from the hot box. So I was measuring my mass flow and my temperature difference and using that, you know, MC delta T to get my my heat out in terms of watts. And I was using this for my flow measurements. And along comes a gentleman who was an old gentleman, very well known at the time and within sort of UK energy research circles. His name's just gone totally out of my head, but he used to be the editor of Ambient Energy many years ago. And he said to me, I did the work on these in terms of the original calibration. And he said to me, you're using the wrong tube. And I went, why? And my tube was from 0 to 250. And I was measuring around about 40. He says, because these tubes, they give their error, and the error was written on the instrumentation box that came with it, that it was the 5% error of full scale. So if you're looking at this one here, okay, so my 5% error of 50 is 2.5, okay? If you've got something that's working over 250, what's your error? Okay, if you've got a 5% error of something that's 250, what's that? 12.5%, okay? So I was working at something that was actually at 40, okay? My 5% error was giving me 40 plus or minus 12.5 milliliters per minute and everything else. That's over 25%, okay? So make sure that your instrumentation is correct for what you want to use, okay? So don't just take what's in the laboratory and use it. If you have to maybe adapt it, and these things can be taken apart. You can take out this flow tube, you can put a new flow tube in there that's particularly calibrated for a particular sort of flow measurements and everything else. Make sure that when you're measuring something like this there, you're measuring and you're getting your flows up the top of this range here, not sort of down the bottom and things like that, okay? So something that I had to learn the hard way. I lost a lot of week's work as a result of not actually knowing and understanding that. Okay. Thermocouples, get them calibrated. They need to be calibrated with each other and off a standard. So you can use a water bath. In a water bath, you use two temperatures, 20 degrees and 80 degrees. And from that, and also in the water bath, you normally put something like a glycol so that A, it'll go below zero, but also you can still keep some water in there when you take it up to 80 degrees and don't boil the whole thing off. You use also a known trusted thermocouple in here. So that's a thermocouple that's been a way to be calibrated. Within the United Kingdom, we have the National Physical Laboratory, which is in a place called Teddington in southwest London, and we can send thermocouples there, or sorry, thermometers there, and they will, so traditional mercury thermometers, they will calibrate them, they will come back, and then we can use them in our water baths for testing, and also, read your manufacturer's data. Pyranometers. Pyranometers will give you a calibrated output, and they will say on the actual machinery what the calibrated output is. So it'll tell you how much what it's reading in terms of watts per meter squared per millivolt of output and everything else. And there'll be an error in there as well. And these things will need to go back to get them calibrated on a regular basis. So if you have an EPLI system here, and that's an EPLI system, sorry, that's got to go all the way back to Massachusetts every 5 years or so before it comes back, and for it to be sort of checked and everything else like this. Analog meters, still very useful, still used. This is a handheld one. Some of them will sort of come as part of something that's powered by a mains electricity. Make sure that you're reading with this. What's the main thing about reading with this? What do you use? Yeah, so when you're measuring, what do you make sure that's happening when you're measuring that needle? Okay, if my machine's sure and I'm reading it, no, make sure you're standing right in front of the machine, make sure that the needle is in line with its mirror image in the little mirror here, because that's why they put the mirrors on, so you've got parallel, because what you don't want to be doing is to reading that off to the side, and even though that needle is very near that scale there, you may actually be reading something incorrectly. So make sure that you're standing right in front of that, and you've sort of got everything lined up and everything else. I know it's very basic, I know it's very simple, but these things do lead to errors, and these are sort of simple mistakes that people do make and things. Yeah, and if you wear glasses, clean them. Okay, all right. Here's some data that's come off a DSC. This was some work that I was involved with. This is very interesting data. This sort of like falls in between everything. But this is a slurry, a 65 degree slurry created by BASF for us when we were looking at how we can use slurries in solar energy systems. And as you can see here, that what we were doing is that we were taking the actual, this is actually work done by Stefan. We were taking the actual slurry up to different temperatures, 70, 72, and 74. And you can see the shapes of the DSC curve changes according to the temperature at which we stopped this work going on at. Now, we think it was partly down to the nucleation, what was happening inside the actual microparticles and things, in terms of what was happening. Hence, we were getting these very different shapes, especially on cooling in comparison with the heating systems and things. So when you get that type of result, you have to think about what are your boundary conditions? Of how I got the right boundary conditions set up for this particular piece of experiment. Because you see that type of result there, and especially this 74 degrees result with this peak occurring here at 45 degrees, why is that occurring? So don't always believe the data you get out from the system. Go away, check it and everything else. Rerun the experiments to see if it's repeatability. So we could have a repeatable experiment there, but it's inaccurate. Okay, so we have to think about what our boundary conditions are in terms of what we're running this over. So, random errors. So we get our error message, our errors out. So we'll say we've put our sample in a DSC and we've got lots of different error results in terms of our specific heat capacity, and they're spread over a point. Well, we can very quickly determine what the mean is from our sort of general equation for determining the mean. And we can start to actually work out what an error is because of the fact that generally, when we get a scatter of data, our scattered data will occur around the mean in terms of a Gaussian distribution. Now, if you've got small amounts of data, they may not sort of fit this, but the more and more data we take, the more the actual data will actually fill that Gaussian curve. But the more and more data we take, that's time, it's money, it's effort and things. So how can we reduce that down in terms of the amount of measurements that we take and how we've gone about them? Well, one thing we could do is use statistical analysis. So we can use statistical analysis, and by determining the standard deviation, we can then start to work out what an actual error is for this particular piece of work. And this is the equation for the standard deviation. What we're looking at here is we're summing up all our data points, so all our values x, and we've taken the difference between what our actual position x is here in the center here, and what the actual result is, and then we sort of divide it by 1 over n minus 1, and n sort of represents the number of data points that we take in, and we take n minus 1 away, because what we're trying to do here is we're trying to determine what's going on, and n minus 1 gives us what we call the degrees of freedom, i.e. all the data points. So we've got 5 data points. 1 is the sort of the true data point, or close to the true data point as we can get. We've got 4 other data points that are contributing towards that mean and things. And so we've got 4 degrees of freedom over which we can go and everything else. And so that's, and then we all square root the result of that, and that gives us the standard deviation. And the standard deviation tells us sort of where these lines form here. And they form roughly about 66% of the way in terms of, or 1/3, 2/3 of the way through this particular data there, okay? So the chance of what of things occurring within that particular space. Now, I don't know if I've got a mark in here in terms of myself going to the board or not on this. How much time have I got, Louisa?
As much as I need.
As much as I need, okay. Right, yeah, that's 68% there, okay? If we go to what we call 2 times our standard deviation, we end up at 95%. And then we can actually say that things fall within the 95% of that curve, and we start to look at statistical confidence of what we're looking at. I'll maybe sort of use what I've got in the slides here to take us through this. So here we go. Yeah, this is it. So 68% of our readings fall within sort of 1 standard deviation. 2 standard deviations gives us 95% of the confidence in terms of those results there. Now, what we can do is we can take that particular error and we can then sort of use that standard, and we can actually produce what we call the standard error and everything else. So the standard error of a mean is given by our standard deviation divided by the square root of the mean gives us this standard error, okay? But what we can do is that we can then relate this back to an actual error that we can actually quote by multiplying this by what we mean by call critical T, okay? So critical T is something that we take from a T table, a student's T table, and we can, if we multiply this by our critical T, and you notice I've got a plus or minus here to make sure that so my error ends up as a plus or minus figure, so we're putting this in here. Not to change this part of the formula, but the fact that our data quite normally falls either side of our point here, okay, to say that we can have some, and our Gaussian data is a true bell curve. I'm not talking about anything that's skewed or anything like that there. So we can either have a negative or a positive error. So we put in plus or minus there, and we get this up. Now, you need to look this up, but just tapping into students' critical T into a web search engine, you'll find something that looks a bit like this, okay? I tried to put a link into there, but it didn't work, so we'll leave that. So here's our critical T table, all right? So let's quickly go through something, just a worked example. I'll do it via this method and not by the other method. So what is the mean and error for the following? So here we have some readings, and we don't have to, don't worry about what they are, just got some readings here. So what's the mean of those readings? So we'll plug in our data into our equation, and we get a mean there of 1.495. Looks reasonable, doesn't it? You know, so 4839615. Yep, we're happy. So with that, confident with that there. What's the standard deviation? Standard deviation comes out this particular number here. Now, let's use our equations that we used previously. So if we put that in here into T, we get 1.41319. Where do I get that from? What I've done is I've taken that number there and put that number in my standard deviation. I divided it by the square root of N, which is 4, and I multiplied it by T. What T have I used? I've used a number from the previous page. How many degrees of freedom do I have for this piece of work? Sorry? Three. So I have 3 degrees of freedom. So here's my sort of degrees of freedom here. And I want a 95%, and therefore 3.182. By using 3.182 in that equation, I get that result. So I write my equation in such a way. You notice that I have reduced that to 1.143 because I'm keeping it in terms of my levels of significance and things. So that's how we sort of get sort of data like that there. Now, next question says to the whiteboard. Okay. All right, so let's have a look at some of these other things. So we've got two things that we maybe need to add together. Okay, so let's say we've got a figure here, which is P, which is 1.49, and we've measured it, and we've got an error here, which is plus or minus 0.03. Okay, and we've got another piece of data here, which is Q, which is 1.56. And its error is plus or minus 0.06. Remember to always quote your units, okay? So we've worked out, we've got two pieces of data, they're two independent pieces of data. We now need to think about how do we use those two independent pieces of data and how can we combine them? Say we need to add these two pieces of data together to get a result and everything else. So what does that tell us in terms of how do we then propagate this error through in terms of what my result is that I'm looking for coming out from this, okay? So let's have a think about this in terms of a diagram. So my diagram is 1.5, 1.6, 1.4. So my first point here sits at 1.49, that's data point one, and it's got an error band 0.03, okay? My next piece of data is 1.56, sitting there, and it's got an error which is twice as big or something like that there, okay? So here's my two errors, all right? Now, how can I combine them and everything else? Have a think about this. What we want to do is we want to say is, what is my highest probable value and what is my lowest probable value? So my highest probable value is the difference between that point there and that point there. My lowest probable value is the difference between that point there to that point there, which means my lowest probable value is between those two points there. Okay. So how I go about that is that I write this equation. My best result in terms of that value there minus my best value for Q plus the difference, okay, or my error for those two particular points there, okay? So that gives me, taking one from the other and adding the difference between those two points there, because this point here could be down the bottom, that point there can be at the top. Do you understand that? So that's the worst case scenario. It's the worst case scenario. Yep. Bit of puzzle pieces. Hands up if you're still with me.
Best means, right.
The best means this point here. That's my best one there, okay? All right. Okay. So that's my best point. What I mean by that is that that's the sort of the best answer I've got, okay? But I've still got this error around it, okay? My lowest, Now that comes about because I've jumped sort of something and everything else. That equation comes about because what I'm doing is I'm taking P best, let's call that PB, okay, plus delta P, okay, so that's my error there, minus Q minus delta Q. And I've rearranged that equation and I've got that there. All right. So what I've done is I've taken that point there, and I've added my error, and I've taken that point there, and I've taken my error away. So that gives me my bigger spread of data. All right. So I should have done that equation first. I'm sort of forgot to turn the page over. A blunder. All right. Okay. But you can see how, by rearranging that equation, I can end up with this equation. Yep. No. You see it? Yep. So if we rearrange this equation, so if I've got PB minus Q, you see that there? Yep. So, and then I can take this out of here. So I've got a plus delta P, and I've got a minus delta Q. Delta P plus delta Q. Okay. Yep. Okay. All right. Now, if we do the same thing for our next one, we end up with P minus Q star. P minus delta P. Okay. Minus Q plus delta Q. So what I'm doing is I'm taking the worst case on that one and the sort of the best case on the other one, okay? So you can see what I've done there. So P minus delta P minus P Q plus delta Q. And this is, this will then give us the lowest. I'm rearranging that, so I end up with P minus Q. And then I've got minus delta P, and I've got minus plus delta Q. So if I put that into a brackets, I end up with minus delta Q plus delta P delta Q there. Okay. Now, what does that say to us? Is that my best result for this is, in terms of combining the highest and the lowest, is this equation here with a plus or minus there, okay? So we can say that any error in terms of what we're looking at, in terms of the worst case scenario for any error at all, where we're combining two systems, Z equals P plus Q. The error is plus or minus my error in P and my error in Q. Okay? All right. Worst case scenario. So we can always use that one and everything else. The error will never be bigger than that. So our error here, when we combine these two together, ends up at plus or minus 0.09. Okay? All right. Do you follow that? Yep? Okay. It's called the... Now, if you read a book by Taylor, there's a very good book by Taylor, and I'll show you a picture of it at the very end. Taylor was an American, and he wrote the Bible on this particular subject. And he calls this provisional rule one. I'll talk to you about what difference is between provisional rule one and the real rule one in a few minutes. Now, the next thing I want to talk to you about is fractional uncertainty. And I've got a slide here which we can use for that, instead of just running through the board and things. Fractional uncertainty is where we actually, so remember I talked about 5% of the error? What we do is that we take our error and we divide it by the actual result, and that gives us the fractional uncertainty here, okay? So if my error here is 3.05. So our fractional error becomes 0.09 divided by 3.05. And that gives me my fractional error for that piece of work there. Okay. And you'll see some things in terms of a fractional error or a percentage error. To get the percentage error, then we just multiply that by 100. And you'll see certain things mentioned that way. You'll see certain things mentioned in terms of the units here. So you'll see something written like that there in terms of the units. All right, okay. If you see something like that, if you see a fractional error, you'll see it written after the units because of the, sort of the way it's written and things like this. But it's very sort of important that you understand the difference between an ordinary error and a fractional error and things like that, because you know, you have to just make a quick sort of calculation between the two of them. But we have to understand what a fractional error is, because without a fractional error, we can't undertake the next lot of we can't understand sort of how to get to the actual true rules and things like this. So we've talked about adding two things together. That rule, if you work through the maths, that rule applies also for subtraction. What happens if we've got something where we are adding a couple of things together? Or multiplying, sorry. It's a pity I just can't just, well, we can snip rubbing the board on the video. Either that or people can go and get a coffee. P equals mv. Okay, so our sort of mass multiplied by our volume. So what we need to do is we need to be able to work out what's going on there. And the same thing can work for this depending upon whether that's P equals mv or m equals pv and things like that there. The same thing applies to whatever we're working at here and everything else. So what we need to do is we need to work out what our actual error is. And for this, we're going to use fractional uncertainties. So our fractional uncertainties are P, one, this is how we write them. Our fractional uncertainty there, and I'm using my sort of bars there because I want to show an absolute figure there, okay? So M, one plus or minus delta M over M and V, one plus or minus, not enough brackets going around these things, delta V for V. Okay, so there's my figures, and there's, so if you think about it, so P is that plus or minus that particular figure there, okay? So, where's that, sorry?
Just one.
Yep, you're quite correct, P. Thank you. Well spotted. Oh, dear me. Oh, heck, that means my notes
are wrong.
on the in-path stuff.
Okay.
Oh, right, okay, so I have to redo that one. I can't believe that. Oh, well spotted, thank you very much. Good, well, you're awake. That's great. That's excellent. You haven't fallen asleep yet. So my largest value, I go through the same thing again. So largest value is P equals M multiplied by V, 1 plus, I'm just leaving out the brackets, so multiplied by 1 plus. Okay, so that's my largest value. Now, if we multiply this out here, I end up with something that's, I start sort of, you know, things like expansions, etc. So if I multiply these out, I end up with this delta V plus delta M delta V over M dot V. Okay? Now, the thing is that this particular value here, I'm in your way there, okay, so I'm trying to stand back this way here. This is so small that we can discard it, okay, all right. It's an error, so we're just adding a bit more error in and everything else, but you think back to Taylor's expansions and everything else, how we discard sort of certain parts of Taylor's expansions and everything else like that there, because we're sort of, we're getting very, very small sort of returns on what we're doing, so we discard that. So you notice that we end up with this figure here, 1 plus our fractional here and plus our fractional here. If we do the same thing, and I just change this to negative, we end up with 1 minus SSM. So we end up with that there, okay? Which then allows me to create a universal, which is 1 plus or minus our error, fractional error of M, and our fractional error of V, okay? So that is our error there, okay? That we put into the equation, P equals MV there, all right? So that's our error here, okay? So P equals MV, if you put that, if you work that through the equation there, so we get our result there, whatever our sort of multiplication is, and then sort of our error on that particular part, okay? Now we know that this is our error up here, okay? So if you think about this, what we can write here is P equals MV. Well, we know mass multiplied by the volume is P, so we can put that in there, okay? And we can say 1 plus or minus, and we can say that okay, that there, okay, so that's again. We know that this here is our error in P, okay? You notice that, so if we then put that into there, you notice that P is our MV here, and what we have end up here is this particular part there. So we can say that our error, I'm not explaining this very well, but what I'll do is I'll try and get you the actual video. We can put a video on the memory sticks, Louisa. That's provisional rule 2, okay? So our fractional error in well done. Good, thank you very much. I should read my notes because my notes this page are correct. Okay, so yes. So because we know this is our error in P, we can apply that in terms of applying this equation here. And you notice that this is our error here, so that our fractional error in P is equal to the sum of our fractional errors. And this is what was called provisional rule 2. So this is provisional rule 2 by Taylor. Okay. Now, why did I say provisional rule 1 and provisional rule 2 and things like that there? That's because the thing about it was that what we've been looking at here are extremes. And our extremes are the worst case scenarios. But we're not always at the worst case scenarios. We are more in between them and everything else like that there. So if we look back to actual data, and remember we've got our data and our data has formed curves and things. So we've got our data and we've got our curve. And this is our curve here. And we're going to put x at 0 here. And there's my standard deviation, okay? Now this curve has an equation which has this expression in it. So e to the power of x squared divided by 2 standard deviation squared, okay? That's the equation for the function of a Gaussian curve. So we have that there. And any curve where x isn't at 0, we have this equation here. So e, I'm going to try and write this out longhand, and here we have x minus x, okay? So x is our point here, okay? Squared divided by 2 standard deviation squared, okay? So these are the equations for our curves. Now let's say we've got 2 pieces of data. So here's the one piece of data here, okay? And it's that x, and it's got standard deviation x. And we're going to combine it somehow with this data here, which is at y which has got a standard deviation y here. So we end up with some sort of curve. We don't know what its amplitude is. We don't know what its standard deviation is. But this is some sort of new curve here, which is z, which is equal to x plus y. And we end up with a standard deviation of z there. What is that standard deviation? That is easy to work out, but what's that standard deviation? So this is what we need to look at. The probability of x being somewhere is exponential to our equation that we had up there, okay? And so I'm going to write it like this. X squared divided by 2 standard deviation squared of x. Okay? Yep. Happy. So this is the probability of x. My probability of y is the same equation, the exponential of, what am I missing from this? Negative. Negative y squared over 2 standard deviations of y squared. Okay? So the probability of the combination of x and y is equal to the exponential of, now I've got sort of 1 over 2, okay? And it's the same for both of them. So I can bring that out and we can put it there. And then I've got x squared, and I'm also going to bring out the negative as well. So minus x, so minus a half multiplied by x squared over my my standard deviation of x squared, y squared over my standard deviation of y squared. Okay? Oops. You all right? Still hearing me? Have I got sound? Yep, okay. So, we have that there as my equation, and I've run out of board. And I'm going to have to delete something to be able to write the next point. What I want to do is I want to combine these. I want to be able to combine these as if I'm adding them. So to do that, great, I've gone and jumped a sheet, never mind. My probability of x plus y is the exponential of, so I'm going to combine these. Now, if you read Taylor, he takes you through these particular processes. Okay? So I have x plus y squared. If you look at that there, what I'm doing is combining that together, which is possible, and I've got my denominator is 2 multiplied by my standard deviation squared of x plus my standard deviation squared of y multiplied by that, multiplied by minus z squared, which is my result, to z squared there. Too many z's, too many 2's, and things like that there. Now, what does that remind you of? So that's not a plus. That equals that there. Now what does that remind you of? I've got standard deviation of x squared plus the standard deviation of y squared down the bottom there equals the standard deviation of z squared. What does that remind you of? Think back, basic elemental mathematics and physics in school. Exactly. Right angle triangle, where we have z, y, and x, and our equation is z squared equals x squared plus y squared. We call this Pythagoras theorem. In this, it's known as what we call as quadrature. Okay, sounds very French, quadrature. And this is the whole theory behind where actually things come from. Because our data that we're looking at through this whole particular process is not always at the extremes, it's somewhere in between and things like this there. If we actually sort of apply this in terms of combining our two sets of data to come up with our probability of the data falling somewhere within these particular sort of new curves and things like that there. If we apply that, we can say then our error is equal to this here. So we can say that our error is x squared plus y squared, and that is rule one. So, okay, so rule, the provisional rule is always the worst case scenario. Rule two is the one that we actually use. So when we're combining two pieces of data together, whether it's summation or subtraction, then we take the sums of the errors. We take the squares of the errors, we add them together, and we do a square root, and that's what gives us our value. Everybody followed that? Yep. Yep. Okay. People looking puzzled?
Do we do this whether we are adding the p and the q or
adding and that? Adding and subtraction?
Just for some.
Adding and subtraction.
Okay.
I could spend quite a bit of time looking at the other rule, but. I'm not going to do that because otherwise we won't just miss lunch, but we'll miss dinner tonight. But if you want to know more about this, I would go and have a read of Taylor, which is very good on this. The rule in terms of anything division, so if you've got anything multiplication or division, so let's take this equation here, q equals x multiplied by up to z, divided by u multiplied by w, okay? So when we're looking at that there, the equation is our error in q, our, which error? Fractional error in q. So when you're multiplying and dividing, use fractional errors. Don't use the ordinary error. Work. So that's why you need to convert things to fractional errors, is equal to the square root of our fractional error of x plus right the way through to my fractional error of w. Okay? So you sum up all the fractional errors and you sort of then do your, and then you square root them and everything else. That's what gives you your result. So this is rule two. All right. So I've left some notes here for yourselves in terms of these screens for you to have a look through. And that shows you sort of, you know, how we, sort of what we use.
Sorry.
Yep.
Here it goes from x to z and then from u to w.
Yes, yes, but you don't divide or anything or minus. It's all, so, you know, a bit of shorthand here. So that would be x squared. So that's my error in x divided by sort of x squared plus my error in z divided by z squared plus sort of u error fractional plus w. Okay, all right. So it's all add, you're summing all those fractional errors and then square root them. So you've got something like this here. And here we have variables A and Y in my equation, or A minus Y. When you're looking at those things there, you put your constants into your actual fractional error equation. The reason why we do that is that what our constant does is that it doesn't increase the error, but what it does is that it just shifts that Gaussian curve in one particular direction, but it just moves the whole Gaussian curve, okay? All right, so the constant sits within the error calculation there. Oh, wonderful. Don't you love it when you transfer from a Macintosh to a PC and your formatting goes completely haywire? We'll have to make sure that that is correct on the version that you have. But this is our general equation for our multiplication and also our division. If you have something like a power, so if you have something like a power, you might think that actually what you've got here is x multiplied by x, therefore you apply rule 2. No. Okay. I haven't mentioned one thing, which I should have done at the very start. These work if this here is independent of that figure there. You have to have independent data to be able to do quadrature. Where you have something like this, x is not independent of x, is it? Yeah? So what we do is we do a bit of calculus. So a change in z, and we sort of run a sort of our differential analysis, and we come up with sort of here. So we have n, sort of n minus 1 delta x. So if we rearrange, if we think about rearranging that, we bring n here, and we sort of x to the n and x to the minus 1, just by sort of expanding that particular bracket there. And then we can actually take that, if you think about it, we're going to take our z. Remember what a z is? A z is x to the n. So we've got x to the n here. So we can put that, replace that for z. So we can then take that and put it underneath z. So we end up with our fractional error there. You understand that there? And we're left on this side with n delta x, or x minus 1. X minus 1 is 1 over x, isn't it? Yep. So you can see how we can very quickly get to that formula there. So if we've got anything like this here, what we do is that we take our fractional error in x, multiply it by what the power is, and that gives us our error in z. Yep. Yep. Yeah, happy? Yep. Good. I forgot to say that if I'm speaking too fast, natural English speaker type of thing, you should slow me down, but Louisa would have done that. So again, for logs, then our sum for logs, this is a very interesting one, and our fractional error in x becomes our actual error in z. All right, let you have a look through that in your own time in terms of the notes. Just a quick thing, if you're ever doing anything in terms of linear graph regression, so we saw some of these graphs earlier on and things like that there, we can actually get an error from a graph, i.e. what the error is here. So remember, if you plug this into Excel, you'll get a very good y equals mx plus b equation from Excel. If you use, so this is our equation that determines our slope, this is our equation that determines our intercepts and things. If we can actually work out what our error is on our best fit line in terms of regression analysis, and we can actually work out what our error is in terms of our y-intercept from those particular equations as well. Okay, so we can even, by getting a graph fit, we can sort of start to get our confidence in terms of the quality of our data and things. Remember, when you're presenting data, make sure that that error analysis is on there so that people can have confidence in the results. And a good way of showing that in terms of graphical data are error bars, for example, to show the, sort of the fit and things. I'm going to finish there. I'm not going to spend time talking about my problems and issues and everything else like that, because there's I could be here all day. Right, that's how I get to the last slide.
And the third one.
Okay. This is the book by John Taylor, An Introduction to an Error Analysis. I would recommend chapters 1, 2, and 3 are very important to have a read through if you have the opportunity. You need to go further into this. But a lot of the notes that I've given you, sort of talked about today in terms of quadrature, come from this particular book. You will also find information online, such as Brink, Essentials of Statistics, which is available from BookBoon, which is a freely downloadable book. You'll find lots of other stuff online with regard to error analysis as well. But I would say to yourselves is undertake an error analysis. Make sure that your data has a good confidence level. Make sure that when you've got equations and you're propagating data through the equations that you're undertaking an error analysis of your data. Because when you stand up in front of an audience in a conference and things like that, these people have been around for many years and they're going to start asking you questions and they're going to say, so is this right, is this not right, and things like that. Thank you very much. Any questions?
Thank you, Philip. Any question?
Yep. Yeah,
so basically these rules stand or fall with the fact that your error has to be normal distributed.
Most random data will fall within a normal distribution. Yeah. So if you know you're going to get some of your data like that, you can apply this level of data.
Do you have experience with data that might not be Gaussian distributed?
I don't have data that might not be Gaussian distributed. In terms of something that's more precise, you're talking about something that's more precise or things?
General question because people normally just assume you're going to go Gaussian, but maybe there are some things you should watch out for, like if you're measuring something, it might not be Gaussian.
Okay, whenever you're measuring something that's going to give you a random set of data, laws of nature will say that that data should form a Gaussian curve. Okay, so that's how it'll work in there. You'll get something that's not Gaussian, whether it's skewed and everything else like that, and that's your systematic errors coming into it. So what we need to do is to reduce those systematic errors and everything else. So if we can reduce those systematic errors, we can then sort of, be a lot more confident that our random data is forming around a Gaussian curve and in terms of applying this. Yeah?
Yeah, okay. More or less related to Wim's question. I've done this before, so
okay.
I know the equation. And
yep.
All, but I'm always wondering, can you really use this for a measurement error that's given from a manufacturer for a sensor? For example, let's say the one of the instruments you showed looked like a multimeter. I don't
yep.
remember what it was. The error is 0.5.
Yep.
But you can't say that the curve will look like this because your resolution is not higher than the one you remember.
Mm. Yeah.
So in this you assume that the most probable value is the one you read,
mm-hmm.
but actually every value between 0.5 or lower and higher is just as probable because you can't see it anymore.
Yeah.
Resolution. So then actually
but that piece of electronic equipment that has been measured and calibrated has been calibrated in terms of a random set of data around a Gaussian curve. All right?
Yes.
So that plus or minus figure is the figure that comes from the calibration. Okay?
But you can't see any more resolution on what you read. So
You mean sort of in terms of the fact that it says 12.8, but the equipment error is saying sort of 0.05. Is that correct there?
Yes, yeah? That's what I mean.
Oh, yeah, that does my head in.
Yeah.
That absolutely does my head in, okay? Because I would say that sort of actually the error should be sort of 12.8, and it should be 12.9 or 12.7 and everything else.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, actually, so it could go that way, because think about it, if you plus or minus 0.05 and everything else, you've got a rounding error, you've got a up or down and things like that there. I would have always thought that it would have actually been plus or minus the actual last figure, plus or minus one on the last figure and things like that there. It depends what your instrumentation calibration is for.
But yeah, I find it difficult when I do my error analysis with things like this. I don't know. I don't feel comfortable using some of these sum of squares, for example, for the.
Well, the sum of squares will not give you it. The sum of squares will give you something that's like a sort of a. The sum of squares will not give you as worse an error as the actual provisional rule. So the actual sort of the full summation of the two figures. So it'll give you something that sort of is sort of sometimes it'll give you something that's increased. Sometimes it'll actually give you something that's smaller. So the errors that are coming through and everything else. So you know so quadrature sort of gives you something that's the most likely probable answer, but it's not the answer. The actual answer can be very low. The answer can be very high. Our problem with this comes, and it's something we mentioned very early on, and that's the fact that when we're measuring temperatures at ambient, the temperature differences become very small. So if you're measuring a flow, and this is where my problem lay with regard to some of the work I was doing, I was measuring a flow temperature on a slurry that was going into a chilled ceiling, and it was going into the chilled ceiling at 15 degrees, and it was coming out of the chilled ceiling at 18 degrees. So I had a temperature difference of 3 degrees, but my thermocouples had a plus or minus 0.5 on them, okay? So plus or minus 0.5 on 3 degrees is a very large fractional error. And everything else like that there. So, you know, that's more where my concern lies with regard to error analysis and when it becomes fractional error and how big that error is compared with actually the absolutes that you're measuring and things.
I'm completely that's more important. But I wonder if there is which one is the most correct?
Well,
we can discuss later.
Yeah, but I think you need to sort of, you know, you need to bring your errors through. One of the biggest problems people have is they do not propagate an error through an equation. And so they don't actually take into account that there's an error in the thermocouple measurement, there's an error in the measurements of the flow meter, and that's going to give them an error in the wattage coming out for a mass flow sort of measurement. Okay?
Yeah.
All right.
Thank you.
Okay.